When we talk about crusades, this is like what you have in mind. And maybe this one. But not this one. You see? Crusades become like the most iconic event in the medieval world. Surpassing like the cathedrals, surpassing about like the court of chivalry, and also the Christendom. Of course, crusade itself is a topic that, you know, attracts a lot of debate. There's some people say it's a good thing, some people say it's a bad thing, and then it brought the good influence, it brought like the bad influence. But nevertheless, whatever it is, it's our part to learn something from the history, and we learn from it, and then we do our best not to repeat it again in the future. Now, crusades is a series of military expeditions launched by these European nobles and knights to Jerusalem. The goal is to liberate Jerusalem. Liberate Jerusalem from who? Liberate Jerusalem from the Muslims. And not just that one, this military expedition was started by the church, and it was approved by the church, and it was being encouraged by the church. The crusade itself is not like one single action of a military expedition. It has several different chapters. There were 9 in total of a crusade, stretched from 1095 all the way to 1492. We're not going to cover all of them. Oh wait, by the way, 9 plus 1. I would say 9 plus 1. 9 is the considered to be a crusade. The last one, I'm not sure we call it as a crusade or not, but that is the most tragic. It's just we call it as the children's crusade. Anyway. So from this 9, we're not going to discuss all of them. We're going to discuss only the first one. Okay, the first when it was started. Many other studies about crusades will always start with Pope Urban II and his speech in Clermont. In that speech, he convinced a lot of nobles in Europe and a lot of like knights in Europe to take up the cross, go to the Holy Land, and then go for the crusades. Now, there's nothing wrong with that, but if you start the story about crusades from there, then you will miss the bigger picture. You will miss the backdrop of it. Now, at this moment, on the 1095, the Islamic world already took about 2/3, I would say. This Islamic expansion powered by the idea about holy war in their faith. Their aggressiveness stretched all across 2/3 of the world, what used to be known as the Roman world, all the way to Europe. If only somehow Charles Martel did not stop the expansion in the Battle of Tours, then probably the history will be like way completely different. It was in the Battle of Tours that the expansion was stopped, only all the way up into the Iberian Peninsula, or what we know now as Spain and also Portugal. Now, but yet it takes another several hundred years for the Christendom to fight against the Muslim occupations and for the Muslim control over the Iberian Peninsula. We know that kind of like constant war in the Iberian Peninsula, know it as a Reconquista. Now, with the strong presence of the Muslim military presence in Spain and also in Italy, southern part of Italy, and also Mediterranean Sea, the thought of getting overrun eventually by the Muslims, it's always linger among the Christian Europeans during those time, Christian knights and nobles. They are on their guard all the time. Other than feeling threatened by the presence of the Islam, Europe also experienced some other weird phenomena. One of the phenomena is like the madness that they get from the eating bread. There are plenty of people who become crazy after they eat bread. Now, these crazy people, like, they're just like wandering around in the street and then just acting kind of like really weird. Now, we found out that somehow that this kind of like act of madness was caused by some kind of like, you know, fungi. The bread become kind of like somehow poisonous and affecting their nerve system. Now, it was just that one. Another weird phenomenon that happened was Europe was ravaged by some kind of like mysterious flu. Probably this kind of like flu is the similar flu like we call it now as the swine flu. Now many people they fell very sick and eventually died. It's not a black death though, it's not a black death. Now another phenomenon during this kind of like, you know, 11th century, Europe had this kind of like climate where the summer seems to be kind of like longer than usual. The weather is clear, and then the sky, the night sky is always clear, and then the European, for the very first time, and almost every night, they see a lot of like meteorites falling from the sky. Now, with all of this kind of like phenomenons, the mood for the Europeans was like, kind of like there was this something that imminent danger that about to come if they don't do something. There was this kind of like feeling that the world is going to end soon. We need to do something. Yeah, think about it. All of this phenomenon, for it's just kind of like, you know, it makes them feeling that there's this kind of like desperation that they have to make. In the West, Hispania was like the bastions or the borders between the Christian world and the Islam world. And to the East, we have Byzantine Empire as the last bastions or the border between the Christian world and the Islamic world. Now, when we talk about the Byzantine Empire used to be bigger than this, what you see right now in the map. Byzantine Empire used to control the Palestine area, the Holy Land, Egypt, North Africa, even all the way to the border with the Persian Empire. And its cultural and also influence, it even reached out to Russia. Byzantine is no longer as powerful as used to be. Yet they are still like, you know, they're still hold on into like the as the last remaining kind of like beacons of light for the Christian world in that area. And things gonna get more interesting, because at this moment there are these new fractions of Islam. They were known as like the Seljuk Turks. Now the Seljuk Turks, these are like the nomadic people who migrate all the way from the east, okay, far east, and then they were converted to Islam. And they brought with them like their aggressive culture, as they kind of like carving for themselves a huge piece of an empire, huge piece of a land from one place to another place. Now at this moment, the Seljuk Turks, they are on this what we known as the Turkey or the Asia Minor or Anatolia, and it's only a matter of time that the Constantinople as the capital of Byzantine was overrun by them. They were very aggressive. With their aggressiveness, the Seljuk Turks, they ransacked the cities and they harmed the Christian communities who lived peacefully in that part of the world. Many of this kind of like Christian pilgrim travel all the way from Europe all the way to the Holy Land for the religious purpose. They were being captured and then they were being like enslaved by the Seljuk Turks. Seems that the Seljuk Turks, they didn't care like about this, that this kind of like pilgrims are not supposed to be mistreated like that. One day, the Byzantine emperor by the name of Alexios wrote a letter to the Pope of Rome, at the time by the name of Urban II. In his letter, he said that he need help to stop the Seljuk Turks in expansion. He said that he need help to rescue this Christian community that were being harmed and who were being mistreated by this Seljuk Turks. And he wrote it, of course, I'm pretty sure he dramatized, he kind of like an exaggerate a little bit, because at this moment they were just like recently had this what we call the Great Schism. Remember about the Great Schism, like they excommunicate each other's, and now at this moment, like Byzantine, they are alone. They are completely isolated from the rest of the Christian kingdoms in the West or the Latin kingdoms. In response, Pope Urban II gathered up the nobles and also the knights in the city of Clermont, and he made his famous speech asking or pleading these knights and the nobles to take up the cross in the name of God, rescuing these Christians who are being ill-treated by the Seljuk Turks, to liberate the city of Jerusalem as the holy city for the Christians. By the way, Pope Urban II, he was not the first pope who asking for the nobles and also the knights to kind of like take up the cross and like, you know, go for a crusade. The popes before him, did the same thing too. But then again, they were just like being ignored. Now, for Pope Urban II, it was very special because, as I said earlier, now this is like a very right moment for the European to felt the urgency after all of this kind of like weird phenomenon that they saw. I said earlier, right, they've seen a lot of like, you know, meteorites at night. They thought that it's a sign from the sky, from God. And then the madness disease, the mysterious flu, and also the constant threat that they will be at any time they can be like completely wiped out by the Islamic onslaught. That's the word. Now, therefore, in response, the nobles and the knights suddenly they shouted all together, Deus vult, which is means God wills it. It's a Latin, by the way, it means God wills it. Deus vult. They shouted enthusiastically, Deus vult, Deus vult, Deus vult. God wills it. God wills it that we should take the cross and go to Jerusalem and liberate those Christians, and then kicking all of those kind of like, you know, who are mean to the Christians there in the Holy Land. That is the enthusiastic that they had. And so it began. The Crusades began at 1095. The story about Crusade will become more interesting if we brought out some characters. Now, I'm going to introduce you a two character here, another two characters that alongside in this kind of like story of the First Crusade. First one is someone by the name of Peter the Rabbit. Sorry, Peter the Hermit. I always got mistaken with that. Peter the Hermit, not Peter the Rabbit. Peter the Hermit, okay, he was a preacher. He was a very kind of like, you know, charismatic preacher. He started to preach from one town to another town, to city to another city, from one village to another village, about the suffering that the Christian have to endure in the Holy Land. Now, if you're asking like, did Peter the Hermit went there once and then like saw how this kind of like Christian were being ill-treated? I don't know. But anyway, people believe in him. And amazingly, he collected 10,000 people, 10,000 followers. 10,000 followers instantly kind of like, you know, hashtag follow Peter the Hermit. And then, now most of this 10,000, these are not soldiers. These are ordinary people, and these are the peasants. Yes, I'm talking about peasants. Now imagine, these peasants, they don't even have any idea where Jerusalem is. They do not even know what map is. They haven't traveled kind of like probably more than like what? More than 10 kilometers away from their homeland, from their village. And all of them, they voluntarily, they're enthusiastically follow Peter the Hermit. Peter the Hermit. This is kind of like, you know, the 10,000. Now, another character that I'm going to introduce is someone by the name of Walter the Penniless. Okay? Walter the... somehow, he is a knight, but then he do not have any lord above him. He do not have any land. So basically, he is just like a poor knight. Okay, he's just a poor knight. However, he is a very kind of like what? He is a very experienced knight in Hispania, in Spain. He had a lot of experience, like, you know, fighting against these Muslims in Reconquista. So, of course, he attract a lot of like, you know, followers too. He attract about 4,000 knights together with him, along with the Peter the Hermit. They travel all the way to Holy Land. As I said earlier in this video, the crusade was being sponsored by the church and was being encouraged by the church, by Pope Urban II. Now, one of the bonus that Pope Urban II promised to people who joined the crusade was the forgiveness of every sin that they had. Yes, including if they murdered someone, that means the sin will be forgiven if they joined the crusades. Of course, this is like what? This is like military expedition, yes. At the same time, this is like a spiritual journey for them to cleanse themselves from the sin. Of course, many people want to join. These 10,000 peasant troops that weaponized with only pitchfork perhaps, and also, I don't know, maybe a small knife, as they travel to Holy Land, things got a bit messy now. You know, the 10,000 people, they do not even know where to go. They do not even know why they were there. They're just like what? They're just like bandwagoning. They're just like following Peter the Hermit. They just like saw the crowd. Oh, everybody's going there. Let's go there. Okay. it's just like, it was a mess. And then they don't even bring themselves like enough money. They don't even bring enough food for them as they travel. Now, according to the plan, well, they should be arrived in Holy Land from France all the way to the Holy Land, maybe in the matters of maybe 8 weeks. Yeah, 8 weeks. But unfortunately, they were travel for about 4 years. 4 years of traveling with only a lunchbox and probably only enough coins only for you to buy a snack, and after that, you know, of course, this is a big trouble for them. And then also, it's a huge trouble for every cities, every kingdom, every places that they travel. Now, there was this like one unfortunate occasion that happens as this band of peasants travel all the way to the eastern part of Europe, okay? Eastern part of the Byzantine. Now, as they are marching through that land, they were hungry. They have no food. This kind of 10,000 peasants, they need food. And then to make things worse, it was a winter time, almost winter. Because out of the desperation, what they did was they ransacking the city. They plundering the farm. They're kind of like, they go to the market and they're just like take everything that they want to eat. And then like, it's just a mess. And then of course they will become like a problem for that local city. That the local city have to be harsh on them by by round them up and then expel them from the city. It was a big disaster. And not just that one. The first wave of crusades, as I said earlier, they were confused. They do not know where they're going, and they do not know who is their enemy is. As they now in the eastern side of eastern side of the world, which is the Byzantine world, they met the different people from different language, different kind of like nation. They met the Jewish, the Jew community, and they met the somehow yes, they're Christian, but they speak Greek, and they kind of like the way they worship same God, but then again it's just differently, as the Orthodox have a different practices. So what did they do? The peasants, they do not know. So they end up kind of like, whoa, who is this Jews? Oh, the Jews is the one who killed Jesus, right? So yeah, so just, this Jews, they were being killed by this kind of like the crusades, the first crusades. It was a tragic. Ironically, as the huge army, 10,000 peasants arrived in Constantinople, the capital city where the Emperor Alexios lived. Now, by the way, Emperor Alexios is the one who wrote letter to Pope Urban II asking for help, right? Asking for help to Pope Urban II to send troops to help him fight against the Muslims. Now, Emperor Alexios, he did not accept this kind of like 10,000 peasants. I'm pretty sure it must be like a very kind of like a bad day for him, right? You wake up in the morning, you look over the wall of your city, and then you see like a huge amount of what's supposed to be like the Christian knights and are in shining armor and everything, but what he found is just like a bunch of peasants armed with a pitchfork, and then they dress up like a beggar. And of course, Emperor Alexios did not want this kind of like, this 10,000 peasant army become like trouble for them. So of course, send them all the way directly to the eastern side of the empire, straight to the Seljuk Turks territory. Yes, Emperor Alexios helped them kind of like, ship them with the boats, okay? Ship them with the boats straight into the what? Into the Seljuk Turks territory. Now, it was a tragic moment, of course. This 10,000 peasants, many of them, they were like what? They were being slaughtered by Seljuk Turks troops. It was a massacre. It was bloody. It was just like, it was failed somehow. Imagine from 10,000 men reduced to only 300 men alive, and these 300 men from 10,000 to 300 within one day. That's how terrible it is. Lesson to learn from that experience: enthusiasm itself is not enough. You need to prepare. You need to be very, very well prepared. Yes, these 10,000 peasants, they were very enthusiastic. They were very sincere to liberating like their fellow Christians in the Holy Land. But preparation, not so good. However, the first crusade was not over yet. the crusade itself is kind of like divided into several groups, into several kind of like, you know, main forces. Now, we had still Walter the Penniless. Now, Walter the Penniless, he brought with him like about 4,000 knights. Somehow, he miraculously captured one of the city, one of the used to be Christian city that controlled by the Muslims. The name of the city is Antioch, that you can find in the book of Acts, okay? In Antioch in the Asia Minor. As the city of Antioch finally being somehow liberated by them, one of the preacher, this friar by the name of Peter, but not Peter the Hermit, he found a spear. Now, this is not an ordinary spear. This is a spear that the Christian believe, the same exact spear that the Roman guard stabbed on the belly of Jesus Christ on the cross. Yes, the Longinus spear. Longinus is that kind of like, according to the tradition, is the soldier who stabbed on Jesus' belly and while Jesus on the cross. And according to the tradition, that Longinus become a believer because of that incident. And then he become, you know, follower of Christ. Now, the spear was being kept as a relic. Yes, relic is a holy object then considered to be, has some kind of like, you know, magical power. Superstition. So, just exactly after he found that relic, the city of Antioch that somehow be now being controlled by the First Crusades were being surrounded by the Seljuk Turks. Yes, the Seljuk Turks, they were retaliate by sending more forces. Now, it's only a matter of time. It will become like the end of the Crusades, I guess, as they were being badly outnumbered. They were being like what? They were being tired and exhausted. They were being surrounded by the Seljuk Turks. Now, amazingly, with that kind of like relic, they believe that God will rescue them. And somehow, oh boy, they did. I mean, they were rescued. For a weird reason, the Seljuk Turks decided to retreat and leave the city of Antioch, because somehow, not leave the city of Antioch, but they leave the Christian who live in the city of Antioch alone. Because somehow, the Seljuk Turks, they got sick. In their camp, there was this kind of like, you know, mysterious disease that somehow started to widespread the camp and forced them to leave the siege. Yay! That was 1098. In the next year, 1099, from Antioch. Now, at this moment, they roughly about, they were greatly reduced, the numbers of the crusaders, the numbers of the participants. They continued the journey to Jerusalem, to Holy Land, to liberate the city of Jerusalem. Okay? Now, when they arrived in the city of Jerusalem, they realized there's no way they can take the whole city. The city is way too big. They do not have enough men. They do not have enough resources to take the city. And again, the same person by the name of Peter, the friar by the name of Peter, no, he's not a Peter the Hermit. He had this kind of like, you know, very weird idea. He said, and then he convinced the knights, which is led by the, Walter the Penniless, hey, let's do the same thing like Joshua did with the city of Jericho. Yes, marching around the city 7 times. And he did. And they did. They marched around the city for 7 times. And you know what amazing is? It works. Not the wall did not collapse just like that, but they attempt to breach the wall and it was successful. The wall was destroyed, not the whole wall, only a section of the wall of the city was destroyed. And now the crusaders pours inside of the city of Jerusalem. But what happened next is a very, 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 very tragic. These crusaders, they were there supposed to, you know, protect the innocents. But what happens next is many innocent people in the city of Jerusalem, they were being killed. Including like what? Including like the Orthodox. Many of them are the Orthodox Christians, the Jews, and also the Muslims. Even though they are not combatants, they are just like what? They are just like innocent people. As they were like, you know, their plea not to be killed, but the crusaders seems to be kind of like become like having like bloodlust. We call it bloodlust, okay? Just maybe because of like anger and frustration, and they were all killed. Now, according to one of the witnesses, the numbers of the people who were being killed, it's enough to flood the city about the ankle deep, okay, about the ankle deep with innocent blood. Sad, sad, sad. Anyway, that the first crusade ends there. The city of Jerusalem now is being controlled by the crusaders. And it was for the very first time in the history that the Christian, the Latin Christian, have their own control Christian kingdom there in the east, in the Holy Land. Jerusalem and Antioch, and also actually another one, kingdom by the name of Edessa. I did not mention about that one, maybe some next time, okay? So it was that is the end of the first crusades, but the crusades is not going to end there, because of course after this, there will be like the aftermath. There will be the consequences of their action. Now, maybe next time, we're going to talk about like the other crusades. And one of my favorite is like the third crusade. And yeah, I'm gonna make video about it someday. Alright, that's it about the first crusades. One of the main takeout that we can learn from these chapters about crusade. The right thing, but done in the wrong way, always end up in disaster. Even though you have a good purpose, even though you have a value that can be justified, but then again, in the practice, you're doing it violently and you're doing it wrongly and then somehow with the bad motivation, then most likely you will end up hurting others. You will end up bringing disasters for others, or eventually you will bring disasters to yourself. That's what happened with the first crusades, isn't it? They were disorganized. They have a good cause to go to Jerusalem to save their fellow Christians in Jerusalem, in Holy Land. But on the process, they're like what? They become trouble for whatever kingdoms from the places that they visit because of lack of preparation and not doing it accordingly to the Christian value itself, like the value that they should hold on upon to. There you go. Until next time, I see you guys. God bless you. Bye.